Je suis heureuse de faire cet exposé. Merci beaucoup pour l'invitation. Désolée, je parlerai en anglais. So, yes. Today I will speak about German knowledge of state power or French numbers and equations, opinions on statistics during the defeat of the Dutch Statistical Society. But before I start with that, I will do some advertisement, I must say, about a big, huge project about statistics, the history of statistics, which resulted in two volumes about, and the title is The Statistical Mind in Modern Society, the Netherlands between 1850 and 1940. And there's already a flyer going around. So please take, all of you, take a flyer with you. We were happy that Alain Desrogières also cooperated in that huge project. He came to the Netherlands at one of our sessions, and at the presentation of the book, he also gave a comment, and he published a paper in the book. One of the afterthoughts is written by him. Okay, and about the book, there are chapters of international statistics, two chapters about the use of calculators in statistics, about survey sampling, and a lot of more topics. And it's about statistics as a new combination of theory and practice in the course of the 19th century. And that it was a novel way of looking at all kinds of phenomena. And we also tried to also argue that it was closely interlinked with the process of modernization of society. So it was not in a vacuum situation that these developments of statistics took place. They were a result, they were influenced, and at the other side they influenced also the modernization, the changes in society, industrialization, and all kinds of other modernization, aspects of modernization of society. And because statistics is everywhere, it was a collaborative effort of economic and social historians, historians of demography, of science, of mathematics, and of law. And there are two volumes, Statistics and Society, the first volume, and one is, and the other is about statistics and scientific work. And it was it's already a volume of another, a follow-up of another volume about a period previously, which was published in 2002. Okay, that about, I think it would be nice when there will be some comparative effort in other countries. So maybe it can stimulate you also this day to do this kind of work also for France. And Alain Desrogières wrote in my copy of my volume, now go on a European scale. I saw that a couple of days ago again. So maybe there must be some effort to do this. I don't know why that happened. Maybe this piece. Yes. Okay, now I return to my talk of today, which is based on material about both volumes and also on the previous volume of 2002 and also some little new material. We go to the year 1934. The German Wilhelm Henninger writes in the German Statistical Journal, he writes an article about national statistical societies. And he's telling about when are they founded, where do they exist, what are they doing. And it's obvious that in most European countries, as well as elsewhere, statistical societies do exist. And they were established in a long period of time. The first one we already heard it earlier today. It was already in the 1800s, beginning of the 19th century. And the later ones he mentions is, of course, before 1934, something about the 1930s, 1920s, something like that. So they were established in many countries. He mentions the Société Statistique de Paris, but also Germany and England, Sweden, Hungary, and also outside USA, Mexico, Brazil, Egypt, etc. But then he talks about the Netherlands, and then he is saying, however, now in Holland, a statistical society doesn't exist anymore. So what can we conclude on, by such a sentence? So apparently there has existed, there existed a statistical society, because he said it doesn't exist anymore. So there was a statistical society, and it has apparently stopped being being there. And I think you can say that in that sense, he was right. I'll explain more extensively in my talk. And I think in that sense, the Netherlands is apparently unique, because in other countries, statistical societies were established and they remain to exist until today. In the Netherlands, no, I'll explain that later. Okay, what I will do today is try to connect why did that happen in the Netherlands. And I was thinking maybe it has something to do with the diffuse content of statistics. It's also raised in various ways today. Statistics did mean a lot of things. There were different opinions on what statistics should be. And I will demonstrate that in the Netherlands. You see that also in the Netherlands. Maybe it was a bit different in France or in England or in Germany. But I will say and it was already observed by someone, a professor of statistics, in the 1850s. And he was saying, you can talk about statistics, it can be French numbers and equations, and or German knowledge of state power. That was the more kind of definition or description of what statistics was. And then I will say, it's not so that they were that they exist, that the one existed after the other disappeared. No, these kinds of statistics, they existed besides each other. During the course of the period, sometimes for the Netherlands, it's interesting how it was elsewhere, sometimes one kind of statistic was more dominant, then the other was maybe more dominant, and I will go into that for the Netherlands. And then I will shortly discuss two persons who can be considered representatives of those two approaches. First, I will talk about the mathematician and statistician Lobato, and then first the economist and also statistician Simon Visserink. First, about Reguel Lobato. He was mathematically gifted, and I quote from, I cannot go into where I found that quote, but it's a quote about him. He was a man who is engaged in mathematical, statistical, and arithmetical subjects, and who has an exceptional talent in this respect. And he also published mathematical articles about integration theory, for example, in various mathematical journals, amongst others we just heard about in Ketelaers Journal Mathematique, Correspondance Mathématique et Physique. He had an extensive correspondence with Ketelaer, especially when they were young, not when they were at an old age. He published on life insurance, how to calculate a good life insurance premium. He was an advisor. He was also, let me say, he was not only mathematically gifted, but he was also a mathematician by heart. He was feeling himself a mathematician. And I think I have a nice quote from one of the letters he wrote to Ketelaer. You are already reading it, I notice. That's the way he announced to his to Ketelaer that he got a twin, two children at once. And I'll read it, you have maybe already read it. I have the pleasure of announcing that my wife has given birth to twins, a boy and a girl. I could certainly not have foreseen that I should resolve a second degree equation, which has particularly struck me. I hope I have produced a little mathematician who will, in the future, be able to help me with all my work. So I think it can only be a mathematician who announces the birth of his twins in such a way. So maybe this is a night a quotation for this audience. I can also use this quotation when I give a lecture, what I sometimes do on women in science, because I think it's a very, what we call, gendered quotation, because he is talking about that he hopes to have produced one, apparently one little mathematician, although he got two children. So I think you understand on which of the two children he was pointing to when he was saying that he hoped to have produced one little mathematician. Okay. What was he doing? He became active in statistics, and he was unique in the mathematical Dutch mathematical world of that time. He published, started to publish a yearbook, which was an official yearbook because it was published under the responsibility of the government, of the king. And he took as an example the French so-called annuaire. Important names are connected with the French annuaire, Laplace, Legendre, and Lagrange, all mathematicians. He took that as an example. In that annuaire there was a section which was headed with the word statistics, so that was on statistics. And when we look what was in that annuaire, in that yearbook, it were population numbers and a mortality table. Sometimes there was a bit of variation, but it was the main content of that yearbook. Okay. He also published a scientific article on statistics, and there he used as a basis an article of the French Poisson. I think it's clear it was about the distribution, so it's about probability and statistics, the use of probability on statistics. So, and it was he was inspired by the French again. Okay. So I think it's clear what statistics was for Lobato, kind of statistics he was practicing. Then it's also interesting that he was influential in official in the statistics, what was done by the government. And he was influential until 1848. In 1826, in the Netherlands, there was a statistical bureau and a statistical committee established. And Lobato became the secretary in 1830. That, however, became a bit complicated. We all heard a bit about it in the previous lecture, because in that year, from 1813 till 1830, Belgium and the Netherlands were one nation, and 1830 was the year that they Belgium became that they became separated. So then he became the secretary, but he did not has not done much work. It was more or less taken over by the Belgians. But he was influential in the first census, which was done in 1829, and that was repeated every 10 years. He published his official yearbook until 1849, and then, so he was, you can say, he was also influential, he and therefore also his approach of statistics was influential in official statistics in the Netherlands until that time, because then his yearbook was replaced by an official statistical, by a yearbook which was published by an official statistical, new official statistical bureau. I will come back to this later. Okay, the conclusion is the French numbers and equation approach of statistics was dominant in Dutch statistics until 1850. Okay, I'm sorry. Now we go to the other person, Visserink. He was more a representative of a group, because which I characterize as a statistical movement. In 1802, a professor of history in Leiden started to give lectures on what he called statistics. Then already soon, it became a new discipline at the faculties of law at the various Dutch universities. And it became even obligatory in Leiden, All law students had to attend a course in statistics. So law students. Okay. Probably Cloud's lecture was probably at least partly based on the book, which was translated from the German. You see here the title page of the book. I think you can probably understand it. It's Theorie der Statistik of Staatskunde. It's Theorie der Statistik, hoe. I wrote it down. Et connaissance de statistique. So, and it was translated from the German, so it was of German origin. So what can we already conclude? What was understood by statistics by this group of people? It was apparently knowledge of the state. Yeah? Statistics or knowledge of the state, apparently more or less the same. That is, when we go focus a bit more on that person, Simon Visseling, he studied law as well as arts, and he became a professor of statistics in 1850, at the Leiden Faculty of Law. He was important in statistics in the Netherlands because he was an initiator of the foundation of the Dutch Statistical Society. He gave lectures in statistics. Those lecture notes of his students are preserved, and there are also publications from him about statistics. And there he describes statistics as statistics is the knowledge of what in society exists and works. So I would say it's a very broad, you can also say vague, definition. It, according to Visseling, statistics should be would include qualitative as well as quantitative information, because what in society exists and works you cannot quantify. You need more information than information that can be represented in numbers. So, when we look, we are of course, let me say, people who identify statistics at least with numbers. We are interested in what was his ideas about the role of numbers in statistics. He discusses it especially in his later publications. Then he is saying numbers are a point of departure in statistics, but at the other side he is saying somewhere else, numbers are dull and unpleasant. And he also is saying that some essential aspects of a statistical description cannot be quantified. For example, the intellectual and moral development of people, of a nation. And then when he's talking about, let me say, a statistical concept or probabilistic concept, an arithmetic mean, he is talking about a bit negatively. He is saying that has an equalizing tendency. There's no distinction between the higher and the lower classes when you take the average. He was right, of course, but he apparently didn't like it very much. It's also interesting how these different approaches of statistics, people, representatives of it, looked at each other. And so there is a review of Lobato's yearbook written by someone from, let me say, from the other stream. It was not Visseling, it was another professor of statistics again. And it's interesting how he reacts on Lobato's statistical section in his yearbook. And then he is discussing all those kind of population numbers extensively. He likes it. Sometimes he says you have to add something this, or you have to can delete something there. But then he is saying, he's concluding, leaving the subject of the population out, he cannot suppress the wish that information was to be found in the yearbook about many other subjects for the statistics of our country. So according to him, it was not complete. You needed to have more information when you talk about the statistics of a country. And there is said in the Necrology of Lobato that his reaction on this kind of criticism was, I cannot provide statistical information that is unreliable. So apparently, I think you can say that they were more or less, you can say alien to each other. But the conclusion is that the statistical movements considered statistics as a description of society, not always only numerical, because it was not possible, but in the course of the period, and especially when official statistics is concerned, numbers became to play a more and more dominant role. Okay. What was their influence on official statistics in the Netherlands? I already told about the dominance of Lobato's approach in the beginning of the 19th century. In 1848, a new statistical bureau was established, official governmental bureau. But it was abolished in 1976. There was a state committee, a kind of broad committee who has to think about what kinds of statistics was necessary, was founded in 1858, but it was already stopped in 3 years later. I'll come to the Statistical Institute, which was not an official thing. Then, ultimately in 1992, a central committee was established, Governmental Statistical Committee, which was followed by a Central Bureau of Statistics in 1999. And those two organizations we still have, they still form the national statistical activities in the Netherlands. Okay, I'll look at the interaction between that official statistic and the statistical movement where I was talking about. Within that group of people who were doing the kind of statistics I told you by Visser and others, they started to publish a yearbook in 1948. The reason was that there was a new constitution with direct elections, and they said when people have now the right to vote, they have to be informed, they must know where they are voting about, so they need information, and we will give that to him in that new yearbook. And other people became involved, amongst others Simon Vissering, and it was from 1957 published by a Statistical Society. But that Statistical Society became more official, became legal in 1862 at the initiative of Simon Vissering. And when I go back, look at the year 62, that was after the demolition, after the abolishment of the State Committee of Statistics. And that was also the reason that was used. Now we need to become more official, because look at the official statistics, they demolish our very interesting and important statistical committee. In 1884, the Statistical Society established an institute. And that also was a reaction on what happened in the official statistical world. Because in 1978, you see it again, the second official statistical bureau was demolished. And although it took some years, but it was discussed in the annual meeting of the Statistical Society, we need to do something, what shall we do, do we have the money for it, etc. So it took some time, but in 1884 the Statistical Institute was established, and that existed until 1892. And that's also very obvious why until 92, because then the Central Committee of Statistics was established. So when that happened, the government established a satisfactorily organization of official statistics. Then the Statistical Society had a meeting, and they said, oh, when that happens, maybe we are not so, it's not longer necessary that we are engaged in statistics. They did not say we will abolish statistics. They said we will more also include political economy in our activities. But that was not entirely what true, let me say, with our view, but I think also with their opinion, they were already doing statistics as well as political economy before 92. And after 92, they never engaged themselves in statistics. The new name of the Statistical Society became, it was first Society for Statistics, Then it became Society for Statistics and Political Economy, but it never engaged itself in statistics anymore. First, though, some other characteristics of that statistical society. We already have seen something about membership numbers of other statistical societies. I think you will agree with me, and not only with me, that the membership numbers of the Dutch Statistical Society were 5 minutes, were quite impressive. Look, when at the highest, when they were at the largest, it was almost 800 members. And that was also the director of the Statistical Institute agreed with that, because he was saying, compared with the membership numbers of similar society in other countries, these 652 members is an extraordinarily large number for a population of 4 million, the Netherlands, that constitute a statistical force which will be the envy of many countries. So it was really a big society. When we look at what the people, about the composition of membership, then you see the dominancy especially of lawyers. The first column are the lawyers, and you see they, although the others were also more increasing relatively, the lawyers were very dominant, and they formed also the council, always were they, the council was composed of lawyers. And the doctors, especially medical doctors, had only a very small appearance in that statistical society. Okay, now I come, fortunately I come to a close. Almost. So, my question is, was that abandonment of statistics? So that's what the German Henninger was observing in 1934. There was no statistical society anymore. Was that because of the dominancy of the German knowledge of state power within that society? I think I was argued convincingly that German group was dominant within that statistical society. And I think we also agree that more or less the French group is the winner within the statistical discipline, because it's now very much mathematics, the mathematics and probability play a very important role in statistics. So can the conclusion be that there was no future for the Dutch statistical society because of the dominancy of the German route? I think that conclusion is too simple. And then I compared the Dutch statistical society with the English one. The similarity is that statistics was also a description of the state. There was also almost no mathematization in that society, especially not in the first, 50, 60, 80 years, but at least, but there was a bit more than in the Dutch society. The difference is, it was the English statistical society, its life, its activities was more independent from government statistics. People did more own investigations, and there was more variation in background of the members, especially more medical doctors. And William Farr, some of you will know the name, for example, very dominant in the Royal Statistical Society. I think there were also other factors, but they are difficult to quantify. How important they were? Was it industrialization? Was it liberalism? So I would be very interested to be able to compare the Dutch situation also with the French situation, the comparison with France and the Statistique Société de Paris. Okay, so my concluding remarks on this unique history of a statistical society is that the French group of numbers and equations was very weak in Dutch statistics in the second half of the 19th century. And that can maybe a factor of explanation why in 1934 Henninger had to conclude that only in the Netherlands no statistical society existed. By the way, in 1945, so after the Second World War, a new statistical society in the Netherlands was established, and that was much more mathematical and probabilistic. But I would say, other factors also played a role. And I hope that a careful study of France and the Statistics Regime in Paris will result in a better insight. So I hope that will be published soon. Okay, thank you very much.